14 feet clearing is required by the town's fire chief.
Is that or as required by the fire chief?
I would say yes.
Do we have any a second? I'm sorry, I thought he was.
I'm done.
Okay. Second. Do we have any discussion?
The only thing I'd ask is do we need to add to that motion any waiving of the 10-foot sideline setback? And I'll ask that of Maureen.
In the past, the code enforcement officers felt that because the requirement for a setback of 10 feet from the property line for driveways comes out of the site plan regulations, he has only applied it when someone is under site plan review.
The only thing I would add to that is I would remove the condition that reference to this be recorded in the Registry of Deeds, because that will, for the next 40 or 50 or 60 years, have people calling up the town hall to make sure that it was complied with.
The only reason I included it as a condition is because it's required in the ordinance.
That it be recorded? Can we waive that? I have really strong feelings about that.
Well, I'll tell you, I don't mean to short-circuit you, but if it is set forth as a requirement in the ordinance, then the easy way to do that is just to simply have another piece of paper recorded by the town that says it's been complied with when it has been, then you don't have to call the town.
That's true. We can do that. So. It just makes title examiners doing municipal jobs. So.
We'll look.
Yes.
Judy Gardner. My comment on this motion, it's one I've often made before, is the number, not so much the number, but the type of conditions bothers me, that the applicant obtained permission from an abutter to do work that we've been told doesn't need to be done on his property, that the driveway width be reduced and be in accordance or acceptable to town. Personnel, Mr. Petty, please correct me if I'm wrong, but I got the impression that you were, I don't want to say happy, but willing to go to MDOT, have them do the work, return to the board and say it's satisfactory. Or, I mean, that the site distance can be maintained. You would be pleased to demonstrate that?
I guess what I'd like is if you can approve it with a condition, I can get the site distance. If the other site distance is okay, but the northern site distance, if providing that I can, that can be done.
So when you said come back to the board, you did not mean come back to the next
for approval, no,
meeting?
No, I didn't want to come back. I didn't have to.
Okay, that was my misunderstanding.
It's a financial hardship. I've got a house under contract, and my hands are sort of tied unless I...
I would ask you, Maureen, with the nature of the motion before us, do you feel comfortable, or do you think that other town staff will feel comfortable dealing with Mr. Petty to make sure those conditions are met?
Well, my assumption is that if Mr. Petty and his agents did work out there, and then he submitted through a traffic engineer or another qualified person evidence that the 350-foot site distance was achieved without work on the abutter's property, that the first condition would be satisfied.
What about the reducing to 14-foot width or, I guess, suitable width to the...
I would assume that the center of the driveway would stay the same and the sides would shrink.
And you agree with or prefer that the driveway be reduced?
I don't want to make it any bigger than I have to. I want it big enough for fire equipment to easily get in and out of there in case there ever was a fire.
Okay, then the only thing I might suggest, Tom, you add to your motion is... I think it is required that we do expressly grant a waiver for the substandard width and the substandard maximum grade or above standard. But those two items, I think, are required to be waived. Is that correct, Maureen?
Yes, that you would have to waive them. However, it's always been the board's practice that they've waivers have been by implication.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
I mean, certainly you could explicitly waive something, but I believe with most applications, something is not up to the minimum standard, and it's just implied that it's waived.
Okay. Never
mind. I have one last question, and playing the devil's advocate here. If this should be approved with these conditions, and the applicant chooses not to obtain permission, simply clears without going onto a abutting property and without actually obtaining the full 350 feet of site distance required, what are the steps that can be taken by the town to make sure that this is actually implemented?
If the applicant, and I'll restate what you just said, only cleared within the right-of-way and then did not demonstrate that they had met the minimum site distance requirement, my position would be that they had not met that first condition, that they did not have a valid public access waiver approval, and that any issuance of a driveway permit or a building permit should not be issued.
So the code enforcement officer would check to make sure that this is...
We work very closely.
Okay. That's fine with me.
Let me just make one that made me think of something else. I like Ms. Lardner, am troubled to some extent by the open-ended nature of the conditions. We've had this discussion many different times in many different contexts. I don't, in light of the particular circumstances here, I don't think that it troubles me unduly, but what I would like to suggest is that we put a time limit on the compliance. Whatever seems reasonable, 60 days, 90 days, you suggest a number to me.
I would think within 60 days.
If we could amend the motion to have compliance be within 60 days, and also perhaps amend the motion to say that the conditions of the approval and the plan be recorded, and similarly, if and when the conditions are met, that there will be a subsequent recordation in the registry to clear the record, that should be an adequate way of dealing with this.
I'm not sure I followed what you're saying.
I'm just trying to protect you on the inside. If we record something that says you've got an approval, but it's conditioned on 1 and 2, or 1, 2, and 3, what I'm suggesting is that the town obligate itself, after you've fulfilled conditions 1, 2, and 3, to tell the registry that, so that anybody coming and looking at it afterwards says, fine, he had those conditions, he did what he's supposed to do, we don't have to worry about that anymore.
Okay.
We have a motion that's been made, second. Where are we?
Well, let's see, I proposed an amendment to the motion that was existing, and I don't know whether the person who made the motion...
Has accepted the amendment?
I accept them. I certainly don't want to repeat them, but I'll accept them.
Who seconded the motion?
Okay.
You. Maureen?
Ms. McKay did.
Okay.
Just a clarification. My understanding is that condition 4 can read that all conditions shall be met within 60 days. Or maybe perhaps we could just assign a date to that. September 21st, 1992.
If I had anything to say, I'd make it longer just because.
Why
do we do 90? Just we won't have it back again. That's
October.
The regular
October 21st.
Yeah. The regular October.
The regular October meeting of the planning board.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
What do you want me to come back with for proof that it is 350?
You don't have to worry about anything. You're in good hands, and they'll make sure that you do everything you're supposed to do. Okay?
Talk to Maureen.
Talk to Maureen and Ernie McMahon. They'll lead you through it.
Now, we haven't voted on this.
You haven't voted yet, so we need to vote. All those in favor of the motion as presented and seconded and amended, signify by raising your right hands. All those opposed? None. It passed unanimously.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. It's 7 past 11.
I'm going to ask for another polling of the board as whether they want to take the next order of new business, which is the Gramsci Wetlands Alteration Permit. I might add, I'm not going to be able to serve on this, so. I'll start this this time with Tim Eichenberg. Do you wish to take this, or do you want to pass on it? Thank you. Judy Lardner?
I have mixed feelings. I think it's going to require a lot more time than we can give it tonight. If the board was willing to open it and look at some completeness issues, I would certainly agree to stay.
Okay. Janet McKay?
I think I vote the same way I did the last time. I'm reluctant to continue, but I will if it's the request of if it's the decision of the board.
Okay, Steve Parkhurst.
I would prefer not to, but I will.
Of course.
I'm weakening,
Steve,
but I'll
you're
weakening.
I just remind the board that this is we're only voting on a completeness issue, and that we have a memorandum that we could strongly fall back onto in order to get through this as quickly as possible. Thank you.
Well, I'm going to have to excuse myself from this issue because of the conflict. And Janet McKay will be running the show.
Alias Chairman Pumpkin.
Pumpkin. Okay, that's a good point. Maureen brings an interesting point, and it's actually one I thought of during the last time, which is that we also have one other applicant that is waiting beyond this. And in all fairness to him, that would be the Highland Subdivision request for amendment to a previous subdivision and approval of letter of credit. We should probably decide now whether or not Mr. Kennedy can go home now or hang around for a little bit longer. I'm looking at you, Tom.
Oh, you are?
Yes.
I have no problem with staying.
Okay.
Assuming that we can proceed fairly quickly through this completeness issue, I have no problem entertaining the last one.
You say no again. What?
I will be leaving prior to the Highland.
Oh, that's right. You have to. Okay. Sure. We are all punchy. Heaven knows what we're going to get for review. And in my stead, Janet McKay will be chair.
Good evening. For the benefit of the viewers who are still with us on the video, this is my application here, an application for an underground utilities wetland permit. Five families represented by Dr. Reed Gramsci, is it?
Yes.
Requesting a wetlands alteration permit for placement of underground utilities and construction of an access road in the area of Cunner Lane and Sunrise Drive. Plan to be reviewed in compliance with Section 19-3-903 of the Wetlands Regulations. This is application completeness at this point. I take it, Dr. Gramsci, that you have a copy of the July 21st memorandum prepared by the town planner?
Yes, I do.
Could I ask the town planner really to go through very quickly, or maybe we should ask, how can we do this as expeditiously as possible, I guess?
I'd be happy to go over if everyone has a copy of the checklist, which is attached to your memo as attachment 2, what I'll do is just follow down on the left-hand column, starting with item B. The ordinance requires that 1-foot and 2-foot contours be prepared on the plans. The applicant has requested a waiver of that item. I'll just continue unless there's a question. Under item E, a written description of the vegetative cover on the site. That's another item that the applicant has requested to be waived. Under item H, location and flow of all existing water courses, ponds, and standing water. There is standing water in the trench on the site the last time I was there, and that's not indicated on the plan. Under item I, stormwater runoff plan prepared by a professional engineer. This is another item that's been requested to be waived under item K. Information on the exact sites for all proposed draining, filling, grading, dredging. There was, in addition to the digging of a trench, the construction of a road to get to the trench, a significant amount of fill was placed in the area to put the road in, and the description of the fill or the amount of fill and what is supposed to be, whether it's going to remain or not, has not been included in the presentation. Under item L, L is a requirement in the wetlands regulations that there's a statement why the proposed activity cannot be located at other sites. The trench for the utility runs adjacent to a driveway and then connects into a driveway, and there is no statement as to why the utilities cannot have been placed in the driveway rather than parallel to the driveway. The final item is evidence of right title or interest. There are five families that are involved in this process, as well as Central Maine Power. There was not a survey prepared for all five properties. However, there was a plan that identified who the property owners were, and those property owners are also recorded in the assessor's records. For this reason, the board may not want to use the usual standard of demonstrating an evidence in right title or interest in the property through a land survey. Those are the items I have. If there are any questions.
Questions from the board?
I'll start.
Ms. Lardner?
Maureen, is there a staff opinion from either yourself, code enforcement, or the town engineer that the waiver of the contours will in any way affect our review?
I guess I've been out to the site and visited the site, and I'm very familiar with what the contours are like in that area. Perhaps I think it's significant that the board understand what the contours and 24 contours on the plan that you have right now, I don't think conveys that idea of where they are. However, the board may want to schedule a site walk and find that they have a sufficient understanding and not need that information. The one concern I do have is with the question of the placement of fill and if there is supposed to be removal of fill, that might be a problem in figuring out how far you go before you're back to the regular land.
I, for one, am a little uncomfortable with that waiver request. With respect to the second one on the wetland vegetation, there's no disputation that this area is, in fact, a wetland, is there?
No.
They just don't want to show the vegetation that's existing?
Right. Okay. The only thing that would do for you is that it's possible that there may be not very poorly drained soils. The way the wetlands ordinance is structured, if you have less than an acre of something that would otherwise be zoned critical wetland, then it's considered wetland protection zone. The soils in this area don't qualify for a critical wetland, even if there was more than an acre. Mm-hmm. However, the vegetation might do that. But in either case, there's less than an acre. It's just wetland protection zone. I don't know if that would have any influence on the board's review of this project. That's the only impact I can see there being.
Okay. I don't think I'd have a problem with that waiver, but I am. I'm concerned with L, a statement why the utilities are proposed to be located as such, and the greater question, which I don't really want to address right now, is why the work has already gone ahead. That really bothers me. But K, on top of that, knowing that there has been fill placed, I would feel very uncomfortable as a board member, given the concern in this town over wetlands, to waive that information, knowing the type of fill or the extent of it being deposited on that site. And I think those are my only comments now.
Other comments from board members?
Madam Chair, I'm a little slow to make comment because it's not an easy plan to read. And perhaps a site visit would help them. It's not just the lack of contour to be able to read this. I think most of us are pretty capable at reading plans, and this is not an easy one. I have similar concerns as Judy has, and I think maybe the only way to resolve some of those is to see how quickly we can line up a site visit, try to determine whether this planning board, number one, whether this requires any public hearing. It does
okay. Require
I
public hearing.
I guess part of it is how quickly we can set a public hearing site walk.
Well, the first issue before us is completeness, because
sorry,
we don't want to schedule a public hearing until we have a complete application. I must say, just in passing, Dr. Gramsci, that I used to live on Hannaford Cove Road for a year, and I have trouble reading the plan. So,
Perhaps I could explain some things about it, just to go over things, so just a brief history of all this, if you will indulge me for a few minutes.
I think you, well, in terms of completeness, what we're looking for is just a very straightforward something. Do we have enough in terms of the materials before us to deem the application complete? If we do that, what we would do is say it was complete and then schedule a public hearing, and at that time we'd ask you to go through whatever background you felt was appropriate. But especially in light of the hour tonight, if you don't mind, I'd like to stick with questions from the board, unless the board has particular questions for you. Mr. Emery?
I guess my comments follow very closely with Judy Lardner's. However, given the nature of this project, that it's a utility project, that it's a trench, and it's currently, my understanding, that it's disrupted and there's exposed soils on the site, I think it's in the best interest of everyone involved to move this along as expeditiously as possible. I would be willing to move to a public hearing, assuming that the applicant can get materials to the board in time for that public hearing. And I would be very pleased to at least express what I would like to see for additional material. So what I'm saying is I'm willing to give this approval, accept it as complete, as long as other material comes up prior to the public hearing.
Why don't you be specific now about what other material
what
you
I'd
might
like
need.
To see is there's a reference in the letter that the area will return to its natural state. I think part of if you do go before DEP, you will have to show evidence of how you're going to revegetate the area, and even more things that may be more detailed than what we're requesting in this completeness list. So I'd certainly expect to have an explanation of the mitigation measures. The only other question I have in terms of right, title, and interest is what form this owner, the ownership, whether there's an easement involved, those issues, and how that is recorded on whomever's property is being taken up here. I think the board needs some evidence of that.
The power company has obtained easements from the property owners involved. You would like copies of those easements?
Yes.
Anything further, Mr. Emery?
No, that's all.
Madam Chair?
Ms. Lardner?
Kind of following what Tom has said, as I can appreciate trying to move this along so we can get out to the site and schedule the public hearing. And I would like to ask Maureen if, could we make a motion for completeness that would recognize that these items are not provided now? I don't want to use the term waiver, because I don't think that's
no,
what we're
that's
after.
Not what I, no.
Conditional completeness.
No, I don't like that either. That we find it complete, perhaps given the nature that the land is disturbed and we recognize that the project should be moved along, and clearly indicate that this information is still required. Is that somehow getting us into a legal mess?
I believe the problem we've had in the past is that the information may or may not be submitted, or it may not be submitted to the extent that the board is satisfied with it. But if you go ahead and schedule a public hearing, I advertise a public hearing at the town's expense. The public has an opportunity to review plans which may not be complete, and the extent of their public comment may be on plans that are not complete. Alternately, the board may want to extend the public hearing, and we incur additional costs in terms of advertising and noticing. So it's been difficult in the past. Certainly, if it's something the board wants to go forward with, we certainly can try it again. I frankly am very uncomfortable being the final arbiter of completeness.
I don't think we're suggesting that in this case. We do not have a mechanism that if we were to have to continue the public hearing due to, say, a lack of performance on the part of the applicant, that we can have them pay those monies for advertising?
No.
There is not.
And that's the purpose of completeness, as I understand it, is to have us determine that. Frankly, if you don't mind my sticking my two cents in here, I'm not prepared to jump through hoops because this applicant has gone ahead and opened up the ground. I mean, I have to tell you that, if anything, I'm prepared to try to move in the way in which we normally do, but I don't see why we have to do it faster because the applicant has pressed us in what's potentially not a very appropriate manner. Any further comments from the board?
I have a question, and I'm going to sound stupid for asking it, I guess, but where was I supposed to glean the idea that there was that this was partially finished?
It says after the fact wetlands alteration permit in line one, Steve. You just go to the meat of the question and miss
the
question.
Oh, that's what after the fact means. Okay, that's supposed to be. Okay. I didn't get down to the site, so and I try to usually.
I was remiss earlier in noticing that we have six people sitting who are potential voters, and I need to appoint somebody. Ms. Lardner, would you serve as the voting member on this particular matter? For my comments, Dr. Gramsci, to the extent that they haven't already been covered by other people, I would suggest that because we have more than one owner involved, I'd simply like to know who the five owners are of the particular lots. I take it that the Marshall lot is the one at the top of the hill, but I can't tell that from what the documentation is that's before me. And if possible, well, I was thinking that the document before us might be covering a broader area. It might be a little easier to see what it is that's being accomplished. But at any rate, I guess I would say that I'm disturbed by the waiver request on B for the 1 and 2 foot, the waiver of the 1 and 2 foot contours for the same reasons that Ms. Lardner indicated. I'm not so concerned about E, about H, or about I. I'd certainly like to have more of a description of the fill, which would be K, and I'd like to have some response to the to L, the comment at L, which is the indication of why the utilities weren't. I mean, I presume there is a reason for it, but again,
absolutely,
I'd like to see what the reason is, and I suppose that if we can get, not suppose, I would normally like to see a land survey. However, I'd know that they're expensive and that this is simply a matter of utility. So if the proffered survey can be improved in a way that won't cost an arm and a leg, I'm prepared to try to see something that's a bit of an improvement on what we have without going to terrible expense. But those are my comments.
I think that's a good summary of what I would concur with as far as a matter of being complete. I'd agree with those. I think now it's a case of, here's a way to get to the next meeting, which is satisfactory both to our planner and to this board, without simply saying, no, it's not complete. We'll get to try it again next month.
Madam Chair, I don't remember if Tom had said this, but I certainly could would like to see some erosion control plan. I don't know.
No, I didn't mention that. That's
you
a good
didn't.
Point.
Yeah.
Yes.
I have one other question for the applicant. Has CMP prepared any document for you, any drawing that indicates the location or length or depth of the trench or a typical cross section?
No, they haven't. They've communicated directly with the contractor in terms of the specifics of the trench and the sand in the bottom of the trench, matters of that sort.
So there's no field drawing that indicates the alignment or anything of that nature?
There's the alignment of the trench itself is outlined on the papers that you have and the position of the trench.
That was prepared by a soil scientist?
That's correct.
It's not something from either the contractor or CMP engineering?
No.
To follow up on Mr. Emery's point, though, would you be willing to try? Normally, what we do, the first page of the survey that we see is a looking at it from above, like what it is that you've proffered to us. But whenever we're talking about disturbance of the ground, we usually see on the second page of a survey a cross section of what it looks like from the side or would look like, so we can tell how far down the trench is, what would be in the bottom of it, what the materials are, what the splaying is. And if there are documents which exist, correspondence, whatever, back and forth from CMP to the contractor, that might be a substitute for us that would help us understand what it is that we're looking at.
I think that could be provided. My understanding is this is just a basic standard form for burying cable. It has to be buried so many feet deep. It has to be surrounded with certain soils that do not contain rocks, things of that sort.
Well, again, if you could just get us some basic information, I think it would be useful. Does the town planner want to address the suggestion that we could get from point A to point B without having to deem the application incomplete at this session?
The only way I can see of doing it is to identify the items that you would like the applicant to submit and to have that be submitted by the deadline. And then I will basically have to determine whether there's sufficient information there to advertise for a public hearing.
Does the deadline coincide with a reasonable amount of time to publicize or whatever? Let people know.
The notice for the public hearing would go out a week after the information has been received.
What's the deadline for submission to the regular August meeting of the board?
I believe the August meeting is August 18th. There's an 18-day submission deadline, so it will be August 1st.
Which is 10 days from now. And are you suggesting that if the applicant got everything to you by the 1st of August that you could make that determination and still send a notice out?
Yes. I mean, I guess the thing I'm most uncomfortable about is me making that determination.
Yeah, I for one would resist having you do that for more than one item, and it looks like we've got about four or five here, but that's my own suggestion.
I was just going to say, my gut feeling is not to have this complete tonight. But if it were the preference of the board, for reasons that Tom and even I indicated, that we might want to go forward, Maureen, would you feel more comfortable, and Janet, it would be up to you, to have consultation with the acting chair on determining completeness?
That was an option, because under the ordinance right now, with me determining completeness, if I were to determine something to be incomplete, it would be in consultation with the chair. Acting in this particular case would be.
I don't have any objection to that. If Maureen were to ask me, I would certainly consult with her. I just feel as though we are shirking responsibility in determining completeness, mm-hmm. and that the whole reason we have to determine completeness to start with is to make a decision about whether we have enough to go on and have a substantive discussion. But we've had this discussion before, too. So, Mr. Emery?
I would only add to that. I guess the greater risk to the applicant in that case is that when the applicant comes back for a public hearing, there may be issues that the board identifies because of the lack of information early on that would delay you an additional meeting. And that's a very real possibility, I would think. I don't know if you were here. We're very, very sensitive to the issue of schedule, but we're also sensitive to the issue of abutters being notified properly, and that all of the information that's necessary for abutters and for staff and the planning board members to make a reasonable review of the project is done expeditiously. I guess I'm very, I look at a bigger picture here. I look at a bigger picture of visual impact and other things that are going on at the same time. So I'm interested in moving this along as quickly as possible. But not having seen the material, I don't know what the mitigation plan is going to look like. I'm trusting that it will be a complete package. It sounds like an extremely ambitious schedule, but if you can meet that schedule, I'm willing to bend over backwards in this one instance to move this thing along as quickly as possible. I'm certainly by no implication asking my fellow board members to take the same attitude. I don't. They're very independent lot, as you can see, but I certainly don't want that implication either.
Madam Chair,
Mr. Edson.
Just ask the applicant. Do you feel that you heard the list of
Actually, I'm a little bit unclear on the specifics of exactly what you'd like from this list. Many of these things I could just go right down now and answer the questions right now. But some of the things like the mitigation measures, that has to be, I assume, prepared by the soil scientist. There's a silt fence that is already there, as per Ernie McVane's request. That's been done from day one. There's a notification in here as to how it would be reseeded in the vegetation, and the soil scientist has said this, it would revert to its natural state. That's our goal.
Well, how about, for instance, the issue of 2-foot contours versus 20-foot contours? Yeah. Is that something that's attainable within 10 days?
The soil scientist answered that question in his request for a contour, or a request for a waiver from that, and it's outlined in a one-paragraph statement in his first page of his talk. I think he could answer that question better than I could, and that was his reasons for requesting it. It's a linear feature. It's going to be retained to its. It's above the flood line. In my opinion, the valuable information to be gained with topographic data would be for delineation of the 100-year flood elevations. And he shows where the flood elevations are.
I appreciate his comments. I've already read that, but it doesn't make it any easier to read the plan. That's the problem.
I guess the question would be that the purpose of doing that and going to that expense would be for you to be able to read the plan easier.
Mm.
And I don't know whether that could be done in time, and we would look into the expense of all that.
Okay.
Madam Chair?
Ms. Lardner.
I don't know if this will get this going at all, but as one board member, I think the only waivers that I would consider granting with respect to completeness would be the provision of the wetland vegetation assessment, and we don't have a letter for it, but the evidence of right title and interest. I think I'm basing that on Maureen saying that these applicants are identified in the tax assessor's record. Some of these other things could be reasonable requests, but since we don't have enough information, I couldn't feel like waiving it, so it's a catch-22, and I would lean toward requiring the information so we know what we're looking at. I personally, I think, after listening to what we've all had to say, would not favor some finding of completeness tonight.
Do you care to make a motion?
Sure. I propose the following motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Reed and Patty Gramsci and Neighbors for a wetlands alteration permit for underground utilities and construction of an access road in the area of Cunner Lane and Sunrise Drive is deemed incomplete.
Do I hear a second? I'll second the motion. Any discussion of the motion?
I think if we are considering deeming it incomplete, then as before, we'll try it again perhaps and make suggestions as to what would be complete, what, so we don't waste any more time. I think the motion may be the only reasonable solution.
Any further discussion of the motion? All in favor of deeming the application incomplete at this time, raise your right hand. All opposed? 4-1, Mr. Emery opposed. Dr. Gramsci, I certainly, Mr. Edsel, would you like to take a stab at what's, maybe the town planner would like to take a stab. Let's make it as clear as we can about why it is that we're deeming this incomplete so that we can move ahead.
My understanding is that item B, that you are requesting 2-foot contours.
Mm-hmm.
And that's for the area around and including the wetlands, so you are waiving at least the provision of 1-foot contours.
Mm.
Item E is waived.
Yes.
Item H is waived.
Ms. Larden, do you care about that?
Only to the extent that staff did, and if the rest of the board members don't particularly care, I don't.
Waived.
Item I is you want the provision of an erosion control plan? Under item K,
description of fill.
You do want the description of fill in terms of quantity?
Yes.
And I assume what would go along with that is if the fill is going to be removed, we need to know to what extent.
Okay.
Final grades.
Under item L, you would like a statement? Under evidence of right title and interest, that was going to be waived.
With the
I'm going to mention the CMP easement.
The easements, yes.
Except you want the provision of the easements.
That's correct.
Okay.
And I'd like to see the particular owners identified on the plan so we can reference the written board.
I didn't catch that last one.
The owners of each lot would be identified on the plan.
I guess the only one that isn't identified is the last one on the point. So we've identified 4 to 5. These are labeled lot 32, lot 32C. Lot 31, lot
30. I think we're looking for the
actual
names.
Yeah,
when you talk about
of the applicants,
Marshall
the five applicants, where do the five applicants live in the neighborhood? I have no idea.
It's listed.
Dr. Gramsci, just so you know, typically plans are labeled like now or formally and give the name. And it's a lot easier to refer to them, you know, if we see those names. I think that's all the board is asking.
Okay.
Apparently. I see. Exhibit D1 actually has the information on a separate page about matching up lot numbers and names. Mm-hmm. I didn't notice that, but if the names could be just imposed so that when we're talking about the Marshall lot or whatever it is, it'll be very easy to tell what we're talking about. Any further comment on this one?
Can I just see if I understand this correctly? We'd like the names on the lots. We'd like the copies of the easements that have been submitted to CMP. And then according to the memorandum, we'd like written responses to I, K, and L.
Yes.
And the waiver's denied for B, and you would like a map with 2-foot contours in favor of 20, rather than the 20-foot contours.
Correct. Yes.
Madam Chair.
We have granted your waiver with respect to the 1-foot contours, but certainly would like to see 2-foot contours. Ms. Larden?
Just in following Tom's request and reasonable one to have the easements, would the board also expect to see those easements delineated on the plan, the extent of them, or is that not your intent, Tom?
Are they defined as such? I don't know. I mean, is it...
I don't know.
Is it just say, is the easement defined by meets and bounds, or it's simply some other form of description?
I'd have to read those again. My property didn't have to have an easement. There were only two properties that required easements. It was the FSMA and the Marshall properties that required easements, and the Snow property. Actually, three properties.
I guess then, if in the easement it does give a definite description of where it wouldn't be on the face of the earth, that you would show that on the plan. If it simply does have some rights to cross the property, then the comment doesn't make sense.
Do you have any further questions, Dr. Gramsci?
I guess my main question still is going back to number two, understanding that this is, I understand from the soil scientist, considerable expense to create this, and I'm wondering that if the site walk would answer questions regarding the topography of the land. I think it's a pretty straightforward proposal, a pretty straightforward plan. The reasons for it are well outlined, and it's a ditch that's been dug when none of us realized that wetlands were involved. The ditch has been dug, and it's already there to be seen. And I'm wondering if we can avoid further expense by looking at the site rather than making an elaborate drawing.
Ms. Larden?
This is a question to both the board and the planner. Is there any protocol that would allow us to have a site visit before we have an application deemed complete?
The board has in the past visited sites prior to application completeness.
I would certainly support that, because if we found that on the site, that way also, I guess we still need the public hearing, so we still have two meetings. Never mind.
Further comment from the board? Maureen?
The only question is if you go out to the site and you decide you still want the contours, you have this window of 10 days to submit the information.
May I make a suggestion or a comment? I think the applicant is correct in describing this as a trench, and as it says in Exhibit K, it's approximately 36 to 48 inches deep. If indeed the understanding is that the trench is going to be filled back to existing grade, no higher, no lower, what we don't really know is what's happening with the existing contour, whether the trench is actually going in fairly level and there be mounds of fill, or whether in fact everything is being restored to existing grade. That's certainly something we can determine fairly easily on site. Rather than initial application, as sort of a retroactive application, the issue of where fill material is deposited, at least the DEP would seem to be an issue, and probably should be an issue to this board. My feeling is that a 2-foot contour interval isn't going to tell us very much for the level of detail that we're looking at here, with a relatively narrow trench and meeting existing grade. If you don't have either spot elevations at a reasonable interval or a 1-foot contour, you're not going to find much more than what we already know. I would think that a typical cross-section indicating the depth of the trench and a note saying that the applicant will meet existing grade, and if it takes several of those cross-sections, if it takes several intervals of those cross-sections to cover the different existing conditions, perhaps if you're going through ledge, I don't know that you are, but if you were, that would be one condition. Another condition if you're going through a vegetated area, and perhaps another if you're going through something like a grassy area. That would be satisfactory to me in lieu of 2-foot contour intervals.
Dr. Grimsey, as I understand it, this trench is not particularly level on the part that goes up to the Marshall property, is that right?
It curves around and it goes up and down, that's correct. It's our intent, obviously, to return it to, it goes through a field, it's our intent to return it back to the field so no one will ever know that there was a power cable buried there.
I, as one board member, would be very happy to go out there fairly quickly so we can give some feedback to the applicant and give him a chance to respond to this guidance we've given him.
Is that the sense of the board, that we'd like to take a site walk as soon as possible? I certainly would be happy to do that.
Yep.
Anybody else?
I trust Tom's judgment, and I say, the concerns have been raised about why we're looking for contours. And your concern, Mr. Ramsey, certainly is legitimate as well. Can we get out there within the next day or so we can, if there's a need, then we can.
So we certainly have light after work this week. Tonight is Tuesday night. not after this work. What's the board's pleasure? Dr. Ramsey, are you available for a site walk in the next 48, 72 hours?
I think so.
Do you have a particular day to suggest?
Tomorrow night at 6 o'clock.
I don't have my calendar with me, but...
I think if we have a couple of representatives that can, you know, I won't be out that early, but...
I'm not going to be available that day, actually.
If Judith... But
later would be fine. Actually, later would be better. The later, the better. 8 o'clock would be fine.
Are you available, Tom?
It gets dark about 8:15.
I won't be available at 8. I certainly would be available between, say, 5 and 6:30, something on that order. Later, I'm tied up. But on the other hand, if there are two other representatives or three other representatives of the boards that can meet at that time, I will swing by at my convenience and take a look and let the other board members and the planner know what my feelings are.
Is it possible that all the board members would be able to look at it within the next 48 hours during your own time?
And get back to you?
I don't feel very comfortable
going
by myself.
Yeah, I'd rather... How about Thursday night? Is that a possibility?
Not a lot better.
Would you still be able to do it in the window you gave us, 5 to 6:30?
I can't. I don't have my calendar. There are issues coming up, and I really can't commit to Thursday night.
Would it be inappropriate for us to get back to you, Maureen, or does this have to be decided in the public forum?
No, I think we could...
Well, especially if we're not going all together, it's not really a public meeting if you're going out in ones and twos anyway.
But I think we'd like to try to go together to the extent that
could,
we can.
Could we all call you and give a vote for one evening or something, assuming that Dr. Ramsey could make those? I would feel very uncomfortable.
I'm concerned if we can't pick a night right now.
Okay, well, I'll
do
either.
More.
I'll do either. I would feel very comfortable. I would love to have you there, Tom, when we're there. If there's any way you could go, one of those.
Is 6 o'clock tomorrow all right? It's not?
I'll do it.
It may not be possible for me. I'm just going to have to see, but I'd certainly like to if I can, and I'll try to be there. Dr. Ramsey, 6 o'clock tomorrow?
That'd be fine.
Where shall we meet?
The easy thing to do would be just to go to the end of Hannaford Cove Road, and when the road turns to dirt, just... keep on going and...
The dirt would be right at the water.
Yep.
Keep on going around to the right.
Just keep on going around to the right. And there's a road to your left. You stay to the right. And I will be looking for people and looking like they're lost.
Just so the board understands, when you reach the water, there's just a very... there's a pond right there on the right.
Yes.
And then there's a house just beyond the pond. And you're talking about just meeting right in front of that house, essentially.
Hannaford Cove Road comes down here. There's a pond here. Go around here. And the first house you come to right is right here. And when I see these cars starting to come out at 6 o'clock, I'll be looking for people.
Okay. We'll see you there tomorrow night. Thank you, sir.
Thank you for coming. I'm glad you found your pen. See you soon. The last order of business is Highland Subdivision, request by Peter Kennedy of Greater Portland Development Group for an amendment to a previous subdivision approval. An approval of the letter of credit amount for the Highlands, a 20-lot subdivision located in the vicinity of Hunts Point Road, Channel View Road, Winding Way, and Two Lights, in accordance with Section 16-2-5 and 16-2-4C7A of the subdivision ordinance. And we have before us Peter Kennedy from the Greater Portland Development Group, and I've lost my stuff. Because we are short one person, I'm going to vote, appoint Tim Eichenberg to vote on this particular item. Mr. Kennedy, could you give us a 2-minute synopsis of what we're going to talk about?
The reason I'm here is that I inadvertently did not record the last amendment for the approval of the consecutive construction of Phase 1B and 2A. I didn't realize it was a requirement. I apologize. And that's the crux of the issue, that I would like that phasing reapproved for the same reasons that we discussed in February.
Okay. Does the board, is the board familiar with what the issues were at the time? We're all up to speed on that. Okay. Well, all right. What seemed real clear before now is just getting sort of foggy. But do we have any discussion?
I'm sure I have one question.
Yes.
I'm sorry. Engineer's letter. Do you have a copy of that?
Yes, sir.
Second page, second paragraph. Deals with whether the applicant's going to hire a private contractor to install a water system, mm-hmm. and the cost should be added to the letter of credit if Portland PWD is doing it. Simply get a letter stating so. Is that part of the conditions?
Actually, I was going to take the subdivision part first, then go to the letter of credit part second, if you wanted to. I think it might be a little tidier.
Okay, go ahead.
That's all right with you?
Sure.
Is there any discussion about the approval for the amendment of reapproval of the amendment to the subdivision? Judy Lardner?
I guess just to clarify, I think a lot of the concern before did concern the letter of credit and that we had adequate mm-hmm. amounts if this thing went on, and we're going to deal with that. But with respect to the subdivision amendment, the only changes are the additional hydrants and the fact that there is an official agreement that Mr. Kennedy will be doing the signage. Is that correct? And I have no concerns.
Is he aware of that?
Signage for the Conservation Commission and the road signs? Yes.
Yes.
Then you're aware of that request for the hydrants?
Yes. Okay, I've straightened that out with the chief yesterday.
So there's no problem. You're going to do that?
No problem. Actually, we're just relocating one hydrant some 220 feet.
Okay. In which case, do we have a motion on?
Yes. Well, no. Well, it is a fair question, but I still don't know how to record an amendment. But we'll leave that lie. And incidentally, the letter of credit has been given to Mr. McGovern this afternoon.
Good. Good. I'd like to make a motion for the board to consider the findings of fact for the number one, to the detail of the Greater Portland Development Group's requesting an amendment to the subdivision approved for the Highlands of Broad Cove subdivision, which requires
review under Section 16-2-5. Number two, the public health, safety, and welfare would be better served if additional hydrants were installed in the subdivision. Three, the approved pedestrian easements will more effectively serve as recreational trails as required in Section 16-3-1J of the subdivision ordinance if they are marked as part of the town greenbelt. And four, the amendment request substantially complies with the requirements of the subdivision ordinance and includes a revised recording plat. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the amendment request by Peter D. Kennedy of the Greater Portland Development Group for the Highlands at Broad Cove subdivision be approved, subject to the following conditions. One, that an additional hydrant or hydrants be added. Is that the situation, Mr. Kennedy? Let me interrupt for a moment.
The situation, as I understand it, is we're moving the, I don't know if the chief is aware that there was a hydrant plan for about the middle of Lot 4. We're going to move it into the area of Lot 5, so it'll be 1,000 feet or less from this other hydrant and 1,000 feet or less from this hydrant.
I'd like to suggest that the motion read as follows with respect to this first condition, that the fire hydrants in the subdivision be satisfactory to the Cape Elizabeth fire chief. Two, that the developer be responsible for installing green belt markers on the pedestrian easements in consultation with the Conservation Commission.
I'll second the motion.
Is there any discussion? I have a discussion on one point, which is item 4, the findings of fact. The amendment requires substantially the requirements of the subdivision ordinance and includes a revised recording plat. Are we doing a revised recording plat?
That's what we've talked about. There's note 1 is the note that's tripping everything up, but he's changed note 1, so instead of it saying you have to complete phase 1A before you can begin 1B, it says you have to complete phase 1A before you can begin phase 1B and 2A.
Can that be done in a format of an affidavit or a certificate by the town stating that at this planning board meeting that we voted?
Under 16.25 of the subdivision ordinance, it specifically requires that a revised recording plat has to be submitted by the applicant, signed by the board, and recorded within 90 days.
I have that plan with that amendment here.
Okay. I just was unclear on that. I've seen it done both ways. I wondered what we were going to do. Thank you. Any further discussion?
Was the motion seconded?
Yes. All those in favor of the motion as presented and seconded, indicate by raising your right hand. All those opposed? And it's unanimous. The second item is the letter of credit. You have supplied to the town manager this afternoon a letter of credit in the amount of $193,715.20.
Yes, I have, from First Federal Savings of Bath.
Okay, for phases 1B and 2A. Our town engineer has recommended that construction begin by September 15th. Are you aware of that?
Yes.
Do you have any problem with that?
No problem commencing. I have a problem completing by November.
It's November 30th.
Correct.
Okay. What is a better time frame for the applicant?
Completion is really complete. I think that's almost impossible to do. That's finished paving, curbing, seeding, grass growing. It can't be done. And as I understand it, with my discussions from one of Fred Moore's associates, was that they feared that the letter of credit amount would have to be changed or increased. I have a letter from R.J. Grondins and Sons saying that they will hold, as long as they commence soon, they will hold my contract price for a year. And in fact, the winter prices would enable no price increase. So my contract with them is good for a year, so I can't understand Fred's fear of prices rising when I see prices declining, but that's beside the point. The contractor is willing to stand behind the price for at least 1 year.
His prices haven't changed since January 29th.
No, if anything, they'll be coming down.
Do we have any board comment on this? Judy Wagner?
I guess a question for Maureen is if we left the condition that's proposed in here that the work, which Mr. Kennedy is assuming is all work completed by November 30th, 1992, and in fact it's not completed, what happens?
It's a good question. It puts the town in a difficult position. If the work is not completed by that date, the town has the option of calling a letter of credit, which is, it's, you know, the medicine is almost worse than the disease. We don't like to call letters of credit unless we absolutely have to. However, I mean, after the 1st of November, usually the paving plants close, and you basically are through for the construction season. And the issue the town engineer is trying to bring forward, which I think is a valid one, is that, you know, next year is a whole new ballgame in terms of construction prices. And it may be true that the contractor is willing to guarantee those prices for a year for Mr. Kennedy, but that doesn't mean that the town will be able to retain a satisfactory contractor to do work if for some reason Mr. Kennedy or his contractor doesn't do it to our satisfaction. And the thing is, you know, we tend to extend these letters of credit too, so this is a number that has to be valid for a couple of years.
What is the letter of credit expiration date?
I left blank in the draft that we have, so I will have to look to Mr. Kennedy for that.
August 1st.
The amount may stay up at the same pace, but however, I'm sure Mr. Kennedy would agree that as soon as he does the bulk of the work on the site, he's going to be requesting a reduction in the letter of credit.
I think I'd like to ask this to Tom, because you have a lot of experience in this. I know it's been done before to say that certain items be complete. Do you have a sense if we were to request that the sub-base be complete, or, you know, I don't know if they're first courses of paving or whatever, if there's something less than full completeness that you might recommend is appropriate?
I would really leave that up to the town engineer. I could answer that question directly, but I think that's something that there's a bigger issue here, I think, and that has to do with the town's exposure in terms of projects being completed and what happened at some other projects in town. I see that as the greater issue relative to this. There are certainly ways of phasing projects, and yes, you can put base pavement down in the fall and then go back with finished pavement in the spring and do winter seeding and then go back and reseed in the spring. Those things also have cost implications and schedule implications, but I wouldn't want to suggest how that would be structured or whether that's appropriate in this case. I think Fred's really the one who should be dealing with that issue.
With respect to the letter of, Madam Chairman, with respect to the letter of credit, Mr. Kennedy, were there any comments from the town attorney about revising the draft that was submitted that we have in our packet?
Not that I've received.
So the letter that you have proffered simply just has dates filled in, and I assume also has an Exhibit A to it that schedules
correct.
The work. And what does Exhibit A say?
Exhibit A on the work?
Mm-hmm.
It totals $157,000 for grond, and then we added some contingencies and some monumenting, some survey, and it was $157,000 for grond and survey work, $1,500, $2,000 for construction monitoring, which is a subtotal of $160,000, a 10% contingency fee, which came it up to $177,000.
And then the $13,000 for monitoring.
Correct, which is, I don't know, I'm getting ahead of myself. Bear with me. $157,000 for grond and monumenting $3,800, phase 2A monumenting $1,850, subtotal $5,700, construction monitoring $13,000, total $176,000, contingency $17,600, total $193,750.
And does Exhibit A put deadlines in for when that work is supposed to be completed?
No. The last phase that I did, the actual cost of the roads was some 15% to 20% less than these estimated costs today.
Okay, I'm trying to understand what you've handed in for starters on the letter of credit and on the draft that I have that's dated May the 19th, 92, that's on First Federal letterhead.
Correct.
Has some blanks in it. And
For dates? The dates are July 21, 1993 is the expiration.
I thought you said it was August.
I thought it was, too, but they we closed on it today, so they made it a year from today.
So in the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5th line down, it's 7/21/93.
That's correct.
And then in number 3 on the first page, it requires something from the town engineer saying that the terms of the approval, that the work has not been performed on or before blank.
November 30, 1992.
But you're telling us that it isn't going to be performed by November the 30th, 92.
Complete, no. It's almost impossible with paving.
No, I'm understanding that, right. But you're telling me one thing, and the letter of credit, I mean, what you're offering the town is a letter of credit that says, if we don't do this all by November the 30th, you can pull the letter of credit, and you're already telling us that we're going to have to pull the letter of credit because you're not going to be finished by the 30th.
I see what you're... the letter of credit, as I understand, it's good for a year. So this clause, written opinion, has failed to perform the work as enumerated therein, but not it's not all the work.
That's the way I would read it. I mean, if you tell me it's not all the work, I expected to see on Exhibit A something that said, base paving by such and such a date, monumentation by such and such a date, or else just the three roads, the monumentation, whatever it was, all done by such and such a date. And that date's going to be the operative date that we're concerned about, so I don't know how to go from here, I guess.
Well, I don't know how I can guarantee a date in the construction business.
I understand the problem, and that's why you normally try to
put
it back.
I'd be glad to have the amount of the letter of credit reviewed in November as to cost, down or up. Up, because I know where I'd place my bet.
Did the town attorney have any comments on the LC?
The one that was submitted today?
No, the draft.
The draft one, I guess, was, if the last time I remember, the draft one was fine. The town manager was concerned that it wasn't on bank letterhead and it didn't seem to be any connection with the bank. And that was the last I heard.
Okay. Maybe I'm seeing these things wrong, but... let me see if this scenario, as I see it, is correct, that Mr. Kennedy has borrowed today $193,715, which he's paying interest on. Is that right?
I didn't borrow.
You didn't borrow.
Okay. I put up.
You put up. You're losing interest on it.
Absolutely.
Whatever. It's to his best interest to try to get the roads in and a lot sold and get out of there as fast as possible. Is this correct? That the more work he does, the less value there is, or the less cost there will be to complete it if he doesn't complete it. He will probably be self-regulating in as much as he'll come in and say, well, I've already done this much work, I want it reduced so that he can get some of his money back. At which point, we can decide whether or not we want to. Am I out of line? The other alternative is that we can say, well, he might take 3 years to do this, and it might take $10 million more to cost, and what do we do there? We've got a contingency that's built in. That's the amount we told him to get. As I remember, he wanted less than that. We made it more than that. The only thing that bothers me, I think, is that completion date.
The applicant,
I'm sorry, go ahead.
He said that he'd be willing to review the...
come in November.
Letter of credit November 30th, or in November with, I take it, the town manager.
Absolutely. The previous phase that we constructed in my draws were fine. I mean, we had a... I have no problem with that, the way the town reacted to my request.
How does the board feel about changing condition to being reviewed with the town by the applicant reviews with the town manager the letter of credit by November 30th, 1992.
Well, I guess that by definition he's going to have to, if the way it is drafted right now, because...
Well, it just reiterates that the document itself says that, but we're also saying... True. You're right, John.
I'm not sure exactly what it how to phrase it, and I guess I'm not probably thinking as clearly as I could be. Mr. Kennedy, when do you anticipate actually completing construction? Let's put it that way.
Well, if all goes right, which it never does, I would like to think I'll be done in November. But if not, as one of the members indicated earlier, when the paving plant closes, that's it. And also, I don't think the Public Works Director wants me to pave after probably the end of October, because the threat of frost in the base material is not going to be to his liking. In fact, I'm sure he would like to see me drive over that road for a year, or the winter, and then pave in the spring, and you get a much better product. And that's sort of what I anticipate happening. Get it all ready, pound the base gravels down over the winter, and then pave when the plants open up in April.
Maureen, I'm sorry, Janet. May I see your blank of the letter of credit that you have? Am I missing it? Is it back there? It's not back there. Another one?
The board just, it is a difficult situation. Typically, when we get letters of credit, they're good for a year. It may be that that's the deadline you have to worry about, and hope that because of past experience, the town will be a lot more careful in monitoring how quickly a construction site is closed up, and if it looks like things start slowing down, that the letter of credit reductions will also slow down.
Typically, though, doesn't one have an actual proposed schedule of work that the town can compare the applicants?
Our town attorney has repeatedly requested that we have those things done. I have not seen one done on any project that we've approved recently.
Perhaps now is the time.
I'm sorry, I missed that. I was looking at that.
Perhaps we should require Mr. Kennedy to prepare a proposed schedule for completion. That way the town can measure his progress against the schedule, and if they feel that things are not progressing as quickly as they should, then they might, I guess you wouldn't be calling it, you would just not be releasing money.
Well, actually, if you had, and this is why the town and a town attorney has been making this recommendation, if you have a schedule that this threshold construction completeness, and you miss those deadlines, you can start calling letter of credit to complete those particular items, and you don't have to wait.
No bank in the world is going to give a letter of credit under those circumstances. What if you have a hurricane and an act of God and you can't complete the construction, and the town calls a letter of credit? That's an impossible situation.
Well, our town attorney has reviewed other documents for banks, and I would assume that we could put some kind of act of God emergency clause into any letter of credit that would allow that. As I stated earlier, there's nothing a town likes. There's only one thing that town likes worse than having to call letter of credit, and that's not having the money to do the work. But it's always been our position that calling a letter of credit is the absolute last resort.
Why? What's so bad about it?
Because you become the person responsible for doing the construction, supervising the construction, mm-hmm. and not having the money to complete it.
Okay, but I'm just trying to get through this so we can all go home. If we had a situation where Mr. Kennedy had to come back on or before, like say November 15th, and review the work done vis-a-vis the amount of the letter of credit with the town manager.
May I make a suggestion? Can we throw this back in the lap of the people that are most affected by it or most capable of making a decision, that is the town manager, the planner, and the public works director? If the town manager has a concern about the dollar amount of the letter of credit as it relates to the schedule of the project, because it would seem to me the longer a project draws out, the more expensive it becomes, and has the historic experience. I feel much more comfortable doing that, and I feel that it's in good hands because it's ultimately where the responsibility will rest.
I think those are good comments, Tom, and I guess from what I understand that Mr. Kennedy has told us about the letter of credit, the town will have an absolute right to review it as of November the 30th anyway, because that's the drop-dead date in the letter of credit, although the town's got December the 1st on to say you didn't do everything by November the 30th, but it has from December the 1st until July the 21st, 1993, to actually do something like call it. So that time period allows the town to work with Peter and try to get it done, and if it doesn't, you get the monitored along the way. And there's nothing in here that says anything about the terms of any drawdown or reduction of the principal amount, and that's the way that the town manager could control the amount outstanding. So I don't think there's any terrible risk in just going ahead and approving whatever we've got before us based on the representations that we've heard tonight, and I'm sure all of us would like to get on with it.
Are you suggesting we simply strike number two?
Yeah.
I agree.
I'll be happy to make the motion if anybody's ready, even if you're not. Go ahead. This motion, based on the same four findings of fact that we proffered with respect to the subdivision amendment, the motion itself would be it ordered that based on the information submitted and the facts presented, the letter of credit amount submitted by Peter D. Kennedy of the Greater Portland Development Group for Phase 1B and 2A be approved, subject to the following conditions: that a letter of credit from First Federal Savings and Loan Association of Bath in a form acceptable both to the town manager and the town attorney in the amount of $193,715.20 be submitted by September the 15th, 1992. And secondly, that there be no alteration of the area of Phase 1A or 2B until an affidavit from an appropriate official of the town of Cape Elizabeth attesting to the letter of credit's acceptance by the town has been recorded in the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds.
I'll second.
Yeah, good. Thanks. All those in favor? Or any discussion? All those in favor of the motion? Yes. Right hands. It's unanimous. Oh, look at the camera people are raising hands. Do I hear another?
Wait a minute. We never heard from Mr. Kennedy about the water distribution issue. We possessed that.
Through the chair?
Yes, please.
For phase 1A, the town required that prior to any construction, that Mr. Kennedy had to provide us a contract ascertaining that he had paid the full amount of the work, and we will be doing the same thing for phase 1B and 2A.
So that issue disappears. And Mr. Kennedy, do you have any, is there any concern about the letter from Mary Alice Riley, and do we need to do anything about that?
If I may, there are several of those landscaping issues that are out there that I take it you don't want to review now, along with my soils conservation letter, et cetera. We could postpone that until another meeting. I'd be happy to do so.
I haven't even read the Riley letter.
She said that she was approached about changing some of the landscaping, and she preferred to leave it the way it was approved.
Okay. I move that the meeting is adjourned.
Seconded. All those in favor, right hands up.
Thank you, Mr. Kennedy.
Thank you.
That's unanimous.
Good
Thank
evening.
You, Mr. Kennedy.
Good morning.
Good morning. Is your name?